So today we're working on the Honda Fit. We're gonna do valve, lash, and spark plugs. And so I'm gonna get to work.
looks like we got one, two, three, four, five, six. I think that's it. So way back here, there's a 10 millimeter bolt to hold the wiring harness that just to give me some more room. I think that's all of them. Let's see. Oh, we got one. Got one under the harness. Got another wire harness clip back here. That harness just, this slides that way. So here's what I got going on. Got a 19 millimeter on the crank pulley down there. Honda leaves a nice little cutout in the splash shield for you. So I'm gonna try to clarify that. We got the wrench on the crank pulley, and then we have the, it would be the exhaust cam. You want the up to be up for cylinder one. You can see that each other cylinder is labeled somewhere else. But when you're in the correct position, there's also these marks out here, and they should line up pretty well with the gasket area. So you can see that the up is up. And then you can see the two timing marks right here, line up with the top of the cylinder head or the gasket area. So now cylinder one, which should be the closest cylinder to us, should be in position to adjust valve lash. And you'll know because you should be able to wiggle the valves unless they've tightened up. So then come over to the exhaust, which is just a wishbone, and that's nice and loose too. So on the exhaust side, so we got two valve lashes to adjust here, two valve lashes to adjust here. The trick is you check your valves clearance, because if they're right, don't touch them. Save yourself some work. But it will slide in there. But, okay, so that one will also slide in too. So, this generally takes a while. What are those? 10 millimeters? So you break it loose. You tighten it with a screwdriver until I like to stick my feeler gauge in there. That was a little too much. Let's should be able to slide in there. Nine's in there. That feels pretty loose. Okay, now back to the exhaust. Should be an 11.
So
those exhaust valves are within spec. So what I'm gonna do is grab my mini torque wrench. Since I didn't touch the exhaust, I'm not going to touch the exhaust. Those are torqued to 10 foot-pounds. I'm gonna do make sure that the 10 still doesn't want to go in there. The 9 does. Alright, then I'm going to rotate the engine and next cylinder. So, the next cylinder is 3. That's just how it is. So, we'll start with our 9. I don't know, that's kind of grippy. I'm gonna say that one's good. That one's loose. Ten won't go in. So I believe we're on to cylinder 2. Cylinder 4, so gonna skip on down to cylinder 4. The 10 slipped right in there, so I know that needs to be tightened. 10 slipped right into there, so that needs to be tightened. Come on.
cylinder 4 is good, 10 will go, 12 will not. So all of, I would say all the exhausts seem to be holding, they're probably pretty close to 11 thousandths. So now on to cylinder 2. So I went by cylinder 2. So I had to go all the way around again. So I've cleaned up the surface going around for the valve cover. And I've installed the new valve cover gasket, or you might call it a head cover gasket. I believe Honda refers to it as a head cover. Just make sure it's seated all the way around. I just noticed that it had popped out right there. Make sure it's seated all the way around. So that's ready to go. Honda recommends you take some oil and you lube up the inside of the spark plug boot things. That way they'll slide over easier. So it says, like I said, I cleaned everything. Honda says put a 5mm bead. Yeah, let's try this again. Okay. So, I'm going to wipe off the first bit. Basically, lay a bead across there. Because you'll, when you take it apart, you'll see where this gasket maker. Basically, there's the timing chain case where it bolts on, and then I don't even know what to call the other side of that. I think the other side of the engine is a high pressure fuel pump. But don't quote me on that. But I want you to put some RTB gasket maker on those points. That way, I mean, the gasket on the valve cover, or whatever Honda wants to call this, should cover those, but that's not always the case. So when you get everything lined up and you push it straight down, I think that's seated. So this is my diagram. It's supposed to be torqued to 5 foot-pounds. I don't think anybody's torque wrench goes that low. You tighten them in order. Basically, what you do with valve covers is they have these shoulders on the bolts. So you tighten it down and the shoulder hits on this surface and stops it from pulling it all the way down and possibly breaking the valve cover. So pretty much once you bottom it out, you tighten it, I don't know, wrist tight. You really don't need to crank on these. 5 foot-pounds is very little torque. Generally, what I'll do is I'll put them all in finger tight. I'll tighten them all. So I start feeling some resistance from the gasket compressing. And then I'll go through the torque sequence again. Because they say do it in 2 steps. But it's really... they want to make sure that it's seated, is basically what it comes down to. Make sure that you're not cranking down one end and the other end's up in the air. That's why I just put in all the bolts finger tight. I'll probably do maybe like 180 to 360 degrees on each one, and then I'll go ahead and just torque it right down to 5 foot-pounds, 60 inch-pounds. So like I said, I don't have a torque wrench that goes that low. I'm not an engine builder. That 10 foot-pounds that I torqued the rocker valve lock nuts, or whatever you want to call them. That's probably not 10 foot-pounds, if we're all being honest. Because that torque wrench goes up to about 100 foot-pounds. And so it's probably not very accurate down in the 10 foot-pound range. This 10 is pretty much the first thing that you... the lowest you can go on that. So, here's the torque pattern. We'll see how it goes. So... notice how I'm grabbing it right next to you. So that's fairly... I gave it probably 2 or 3 rotations. Because it'll feel real loose at first. Then it'll start to tighten up just a little bit. And then I stop. Basically using it like a nut driver. But pretty much you're just working in a crisscross pattern as far as torquing goes. I'm not supposed to start this engine for 3 hours. My plan is to put some tires on it. Do a brake flush on it. Chris Fix has a pretty good video on brake flushes, better than what I'll be able to do if I'm honest with myself. But Chris Fuchs doesn't own a GK5 Honda Fit, so doesn't have a video on this. In fact, I was having some difficulty finding a video on this, and that's why I'm doing it. This isn't, I won't call this a how-to. This is literally just my experience taking things apart and my previous experience with my two Hondas doing valve clearance. Now, at this point, all your gaffs should have tightened up. Not all the way, but most of the way. Should take a peek around to make sure that you don't have a pinched gasket. I even generally take a mirror and look at the backside, because it's better to find a pinched gasket now than later. Because you'll just see it rolled over, just out of place. And I'm gonna, that's number two, because I didn't tighten this back one down much. Gotta take a good look at that, but it's humped back here. Of course, it's the hardest one to get my light onto. Oh, I wasn't seeing it right. It's fine. And then back in that corner. Luckily, these Honda gaskets are pretty good about staying in place. I've had on the older Chevys, I remember, I'd put a little Vaseline on them because they'd always, they'd always fall out if you didn't. So I just bottomed out, and then I just give it, notice how little force I'm putting on that. Cause let's see, I'll set this. This does have a 5 foot-pound setting. I'm not sure how accurate it is. So I just did that two finger thing. Let's see if it tightens any. No. So that's how I torque it. I use 1/4-inch drive. I tighten it down. I literally give myself, I think I give myself these three fingers. And I still don't really crank on it. I just get it tight. Tight enough so you don't think that the bolt will back out. That's what we're aiming for here. I don't recommend breaking any of these. I did that on a Subaru once. Nothing makes your day better than taking it all apart, cleaning it all again. This one I'm probably gonna over torque because I can't get a good grip on where it's supposed to be. Oh, this one loosened right up. The other thing that torquing it that way does is it helps prevent pinched gasket. The gasket will tend to try to stay in its groove. So there we go. I got all those back in. I'm gonna put my, this is the bolt that came from the wiring harness in the back corner over here. So I'm gonna put that back just so I don't forget about it. So some people remove the cowl to do this, but you can just do extensions, put them on top of each other. What I'm gonna do mostly because I got it is I got a universal. And I probably won't use it putting them back in because when it gets all floppy like this and you put a side load on it, you might crack your ceramic. This spark plug socket has a nice magnetic grip on it. So you can see there are a lot of threads on these, so be patient. They don't recommend you gapping these. One thing that I did notice, I'm not sure if these were replaced or not. But you can see that they don't wear all that much. That was my experience with my last fit, is that the difference in gap is probably, actually, my gap tool is worn to crap. But I will very carefully. So my gap tool says the old one is about 50 thousandths. And it says that the new one is right around 45, but that's on a really worn gapping tool. I think they're supposed to be 41, but I guess what I'm getting at is it's only worn about 5 thousandths, give or take. NGK also doesn't recommend putting locked or never seize on these. Say the coating on them is fine for, so I generally check to make sure I'm not cross-threaded, pull it out, spark plug stays behind, and then I tighten it all the way down by hand. I know I said I wouldn't use the universal, but for this part, I'm not worried about it. In fact, I'm probably going to get a smaller piece of extension. I think this will fit. Oh man, this is tight, but it just fits. So, spark plugs, 16 foot-pounds. I know, if you have to use a torque wrench for a spark plug, then you shouldn't be around a car. However, NGK warns about over torque, under torque. Either one can make them leak. My last Honda Fit, cylinder 2, the spark plug backed out about 2 threads. So there we are at 16 foot-pounds. I'm really not sure if I'm going to be able to clear this cowl without removing pieces. Oh, looks like I can. So, spark plug number 2. This spark plug I've already had out once. And that was because these take that 14 millimeter thin wall socket. And by 14 millimeter, I'm using a 9/16, and it's not so thin walled. So I guess you don't really need that thin of a walled socket. You just need, technically you could probably get by with a magnet and a 9/16 deep well socket. Just make sure that it fits over your new plug before you go cracking your old plugs. So, this is, I'm showing you the technique of this plug. Is very similar. Looks very similar. I really don't think that these have been changed. They have that leak pass that I believe takes a little longer than 10,000 miles. Be careful. There are fake NGK spark plugs out there. One of the nice things about these spark plugs having so many threads is I can tell that it's not cross-threaded, because it goes down like 2 inches before anything happens. But there are fake NGK spark plugs. I bought these from Rock Auto. I hope they're legit. But Amazon, eBay, careful out there. The Amazon and eBay are not a good, apparently aren't a good source for NGK spark plugs. Last time I bought them, it was from Advanced Auto Parts. Ooh, that one was tight. Advanced, if you have the 25% coupon, they're not too bad. I think they were still like $17 a piece or something. I think Rock Auto, these were 14, somewhere around there. Still expensive, still don't want to break any. Gotta remove one extension. Once again, this looks about the same. I was having trouble getting this spark plug into the spark plug socket. The magnetic part kept grabbing it and pulling it to the side. Clicking, but there we go. On my Gen 1 Honda Fit, this is child's play doing the spark plugs. And this is the Generation 2. You can do them without removing the cowl, but you have to. It looks basically like this. It's just completely back under the cowl, so you got to do it all by feel. Which I could probably do, but my plan is to do my Gen 2. I should have the valve clearances done sometime this month. That plug, like I said, it looks about the same. So all the old plugs are about, on this, 50 thousandths, and the new plugs are all showing about 45, so. If my gap tool wasn't so old, I would be a little worried, but. But my gap tool is ancient, so I'm not worried about it at all. So here we go. Because the people who say you need a torque wrench to do, you need a torque wrench to do spark plugs. Shouldn't be doing spark plugs. They were kids once. Their dad taught them how to do this stuff. So don't take offense. I can get a spark plug close. To its proper spec. It's probably slightly over torqued. When I do them, because my experience is they say that if you over torque these, you can crush the washer too much and then it'll leak. I have all sorts of things they say, and I just feel
Why not get out the torque wrench? You need a wrench anyway, so why not do it with a torque wrench? You only do this once every 100,000 miles or so. Oh. Okay, so earlier you saw me labeling my coils 1, 2, and 3, 4. I would say that you don't have to. I do it a bit out of habit. Mostly so if there's something weird going on, like for example this coil, you can see that there's some heat getting by, and all the spark plugs had a little bit of leakage past the spark plugs had a little bit of leakage past the sealing ring, but coils are generally fine. A lot of people will say replace your coils when you do your spark plugs every 100,000 miles. If you want to blow a bunch of money, you can. Because Honda coils are probably... So you can get Honda equivalent ones, generally for about $60 a piece. Don't buy the really cheap coils. Most of them will last you about a year. And on the third gen Honda Fit and the first gen Honda Fit, that's not a big deal. You can swap a coil in about, I don't know, a minute and a half. But on the second gen especially, that can be a pain in the butt, because you either have to reach around, or worse, you have to take off the whole windshield wiper cowl. They also don't recommend you putting oil into the engine. If you just did the valve cover, I assume it's because they want the RTV to cure up. Because I'm not changing the oil on this. It just had the oil change recently. But I think they just don't want you pouring it in the top where it could affect the curing of the RTV. And I am sure there is a torque spec for these too, but like I said, just try to tighten it enough so you'll trust that the bolt won't back out. Because, I mean, the coils will probably don't even need these bolts, but maybe if you hit a big pothole or you're driving down a dirt road and bouncing all around, maybe have to worry about your coils bouncing out. But I think hook this back into place there, clip it back onto the valve cover. I'm looking back here to see if there's anything I want to connect. or the intake. I don't even remember where this one went. Gotta be over here somewhere. Oh, it goes on the back of that. Okay. I'm trying to just make sure that I don't connect anything and regret it later. Replace these gaskets. I didn't read up on it. Generally, they're fine. I'm not gonna say all the time they're fine. You want to make sure there's no debris or anything in them, because they still have a little bit of flex. Just in case you're curious, I'm gonna put these back, or put this back. That's pretty nasty. Not super nasty, but pretty nasty. I might clean that out a little bit. But that's what 107,000 miles on a direct injected engine looks like. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna clean up these surfaces a little, and I think I'm gonna try to clean those a little bit. Go ahead and give one cylinder a try. What did we end on? We ended on cylinder 2, should be all closed up. So we'll jam that back in there. Try not to hit any of your gaskets on anything. Probably look up the torque pattern on this, because my guess is she probably worked from the center out.
So it says as far as torque procedure that you tighten them until they contact the manifold, like I just did, and then they basically say tighten in a crisscross pattern. What they said. They said tighten until you feel it contact. The gaskets compress and contact. All of them feel like they're, I call it bottoming out, where the torque suddenly gets significantly higher. It just feels like you hit the bottom. And then it says 18 foot pound. So don't forget your stupid little bracket. Comes to 10 millimeter bolts, just put them back in as hard as they came out. Don't want to break them. When in doubt, leave them loose. They're probably not that important if they're 10 millimeter bolts. Okay, so let's reassemble some stuff.
It looks like that was... Nothing above. All sorts of clamps. Not that. I hope everything's good because I'm putting these stupid clips back together. Okay. So we got stuff here and here. To bring the tools back to the tool bench. Okay. Your transmission filter is right down here. If you guys were ever curious about that, you remove down below your air box, you remove these bolts. And then the assembly with O-ring comes out. And it's kind of like a Toyota cartridge filter. If you ever wanted to do your transmission filter on these. Looks like a pain in the butt. Because I wanted to add a transmission cooler to this, but that's not happening. Because it's way too expensive, and so I got another fit I'll just tow with that. Okay, I'm back, guys. I installed the foam thing underneath the intake. Apparently, it kind of sits on pegs on the intake, so... It's almost like it's designed to stay with the intake. For some reason, mine didn't. And that led to a lot of extra work. But we're getting back to it. So. That's why you guys should keep your workbenches organized. I have all my tools and my parts in the same place, and therefore I couldn't see that I was had a giant part to put back. So, We are getting so close.
Even changing the air filter in this is kind of a pain because of how cramped it is. Giving it a nice check over. And other than the battery terminal, that's it. Thanks for hanging out for like 6 hours with me. Hopefully yours goes better.